Hello and welcome back to Under the Orange Lights, which is a live webcast that connects the Orange Theory community with industry experts. I'm your host, I'm Dr. Rachel Reed, an exercise physiologist and OTF's Senior Director of Health Science and Research. And gosh, we have a really special episode for you planned this evening. I'm actually going to be joined by two very special guests, the first of whom is Dr. Brittany Masteller. She has an master's degree and a PhD in kinesiology. She also completed a postdoc, which is some additional training, some specialized training after you graduate with a PhD. She was in school for a very long time. She's currently a college professor. She's also a small business owner of Doc BrittFit and an excellent science communicator. So Britt, welcome to the show. We're so excited to have you.
Thank you for having me. I'm excited to be here.
Yay. And our second guest is Alyssa Olenek. She's a PhD candidate. She has a bachelor's of science in health science, a master's of science in exercise physiology, and she's also a full-time PhD student gunning towards that dissertation to finish up. She also has an additional certification in nutrition, so lots of letters after her name. She is also a small business owner of Little List Fitness and a very effective science communicator as well. Alyssa, thank you so much for being here.
Hi, everyone. I'm super excited to be here.
So we have so much ground to cover tonight, but here's the gist of it, everybody. You know, there's science information, health information everywhere you scroll, whether you're on Instagram, you're on TikTok, you're on all these new social platforms popping up. And with so much information, it can be really hard to see through the clutter. So our conversation today is going to provide you some tips for sifting through all the crazy health claims you see online. We'll give you some information on how to tell what's helpful, what's a waste of time, and what can actually be downright dangerous. And of course, so, so much more. So thank you all for being here. We do want to remind you that the show is live. So give us a little note in the chat. Let us know where you're tuning in from. And here's your prompt to ask any questions that might be on your mind about science communication claims you've seen online. Let us know because we'll be able to showcase your question and answer it live. So I want to get started, you guys, by letting the audience get to know you both a little bit. So what better to do than to have a little bit of an icebreaker? Britt, I want to start with you. Can you tell us about a time where you have sort of walked a family member or friend back a little bit from believing a bogus health claim?
Oh man, I have a million stories like this. Friends, family, everyone. I would say one of the most common things that I get from my female friends is questions about lifting and, you know, will lifting make me bulky? And I think that lifting is more accepted and more people are willing to participate with knowing that it will not make you bulky or it won't make you huge like a, you know, professional bodybuilder if you don't want that. But that rumor, that thought is still really rampant in certain populations, I think, and in certain people who just aren't familiar with how to lift or what lifting really is. So I would say that is one that I hear all the time, even still. And I thought that, you know, I would get away from that the more that I'm in this industry. But, you know, I think some people are getting more warmed up to it. But I still think that the underlying tone is that lifting too much or too heavy is bulky. And we obviously know that's not true. So I know we've all talked about that before. But that's one that I have steered people away from time and time and time again, friends and family alike.
Alyssa, I know you have had similar messaging on your page, right? Even about this very topic. Talk to us a little bit about that.
Yeah. So building off that, for those of you who are unfamiliar with me, I do research in females and sex differences and metabolism. And so I'm really, really pro and a big advocate of giving women appropriate exercise prescriptions. So that's a big thing I see for me. And of course, men as well, but men get a little bit more of the messaging towards the weight room kind of thing. And so something I'm really passionate about, I post about a day, is appropriately loading women, training women, because I care a lot about their metabolic health and all that stuff. And a lot of the exercise advice or prescriptions or guidance you get on social media ends up under training women, which does a disservice to their fitness, but also their health. And so I feel like a lot of what my messaging does and what I try to get people to do is to not only understand the science, but blending that with like believing that they're capable of doing these things that they've never been told they can do. So kind of blending those two together of like, you can do this. And also like, this is how you do this appropriately versus like all that muddy water messaging that you see all the time. So building off that with Britt is that like, not only like, should you not be afraid of it, but also like, it's so good for you to do it. So getting people to bridge that gap between fearing the weight room and seeing like how much it's a, you know, an open vessel for so much positive change.
I love this so much. As you guys know, a lot of our members that come to OTF are female or do identify as females. And so we also at OTF get a lot of questions about the lifting and all of the movement training that we do in the floor portion of our workout. So I love that you guys are addressing this. And just kind of building off that, Alyssa, one of the things that jumps out to me about your page is this quote. It says, honest education is the key to helping others find success in their health. And I feel like that is like such a good takeaway. So this honest education, this ability to kind of like sift through all of the bogus claims that are out there. And like you said, to have this message to really empower people to understand science, let them know that they can understand the science, they're capable of it. That's a really cool message that I think both of you have on your social platforms. Alyssa, can you give us another example of a maybe a rumor or a misinformation?
Yeah, so I believe in that because I think a lot of what the fitness industry does is they either misuse science in a way that's completely bogus and they just try to like, they regurgitate something they kind of heard and slap it onto something. So you'll see this like fat blasting hit, right? So they're taking a scientific thing that is actually explained by science, but they're using it in a way that's incorrect, that they're like almost dumbifying it down. Yeah. And then you have the other extreme of people who will take stuff and they're so heavy science jargony to the point that you don't understand what they're saying. So you kind of just, you trust it because it sounds smart. And so I have this philosophy that like, you know, you guys watching this or consumers in general, you're not stupid. Like, I don't think you should be talked to like you're stupid. You can use anatomical terms or explain the science beyond things, but it's our jobs as experts. And if you are a true expert and not someone who's kind of posing as an expert, to take all that knowledge that you have and convey in a way that's honest. We don't have to lie to people. So I think a lot of what the fitness and nutrition industry does is they lie to people or they hide the truth just enough so it kind of keeps them buying in. And I truly believe that you can be upfront with people and you can explain how things work and you can be honest about that. So you can explain like why resistance training is good without masking it behind some fancy overplayed up claim or like, you know, watering it down for people of being like, oh, it makes you toned. Well, like, let's explain like what that actually means so people know what the processes are happening in their bodies. Or even you get people who are super sciencey and they'll go and explain metabolism in all these complicated terms where you could, people aren't dumb, but they also need to be met where they're at. So that's what I know that's not an exact one example, but I think like using the tone language or when people simplify it where it's like only calories in, calories out, but then you have the other extreme of like trying to explain all these complicated metabolic processes to people on Instagram, you're missing people in the middle of that. And I think that we can talk to people like they're intelligent and we don't have to hide the truth. And if you do it in a way that's empowering, they're going to keep coming back for more because they're going to be like, wow, I actually understand what's happening. And then they have more buy-in to the process because it's going to be more efficient and they're going to actually be able to appreciate what's going on and in their bodies.
I love this so much. Britt, do you have anything to add to that?
Yeah, I mean, I will piggyback off that and just say that's really important. And I think on both ends of the extremes of that, Alyssa mentioned, you know, scientists or someone who is really highly trained in science not being able to communicate that in a way that the consumer can understand. And what can happen sometimes is the byproduct of that is them selling something, right? So they use all this fancy language that you, the consumer, doesn't understand, or that I, as a scientist, sometimes don't understand. Right. And the end result is I talk about this, buy my book, buy my product, because I will profit off of this. I will make money from it. And, you know, I caution people with that because not all the time is making money necessarily a bad thing. However, if it's very extreme and you don't actually understand what you're buying into, that's a problem. And a lot of times just thinking through what the claim is, does this actually make sense? If that answer is a red flag, no, there's a reason that you're thinking that. There's a reason that you are apprehensive. So trust yourself a little bit when it comes to that. Even if you're not a scientist, you have the critical thinking skills. You can think through some of this stuff and not just be, you know, blindly consuming things without really thinking through what you're doing and how that will affect your body and how that will pertain to your goals.
I love that. And I think Orange Theory, with this series, with some of the educational content we're helping our coaches with, we're really trying to be the grown-ups in the room and to help people break through all these myths, to understand the science and to feel empowered that they can understand the science and they can actually apply it, and that we can help them do that. So we actually have a really good question in the chat from Jenna. She's asking, are there any good go-to resources to find fact-based health guidance that you would recommend, aside from reading academic journals, which is kind of challenging to do, especially if you're not trained to do that well. It can be really hard to understand the statistical analyses and the study design and the limitations associated with that. So what do you guys think some go-to resources?
I'll go first. Yeah, I'd say, so any sort of professional organization, so depending on what your question is, or if it's, you know, fitness-based or maybe nutrition-based, you know, can depend and vary, but there are professional organizations that, you know, us as professionals will attend conferences and do continuing education through, things like that. Many of them have some sort of position stand or something that is written maybe for more of the general public. So government websites are another great place. I'm thinking of, you know, the American College of Sports Medicine, the CDC, which I'm sure we're all have been hearing about the CDC more than we wanted to the last year because of COVID. But beyond COVID-related things, they also do have health-related guidelines related to physical activity, things like that. And shameless plug, a lot of our friends on Instagram are really great science communicators. They are highly educated and they provide free content all the time. So visit their pages, read their Q&As, sign up for their new email newsletters, because they are answering a lot of the questions that you all as consumers and as people who are interested in health and fitness and nutrition want to hear. So, I wouldn't plug them without trusting and vouching for them that they are trained and they are experts, and they don't want you to fall prey to some of the misinformation that's out there. So that's all free too. Those are just the free resources.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I feel like social media can be a big cesspool of misinformation, but if you can find the right pockets of people, you can actually get a lot of really good information. I think the key is finding the people who are trained to interpret that literature, like us. So I don't believe that science should be like withheld from the general public, but you might need a little bit of assistance interpreting that. So like, I know all of us, a lot of our friends in our network, when we're posting things, we're gonna share the links to the articles. So if you wanted to go and read more and learn, you could. There's also a lot of good resources now where there's research reviews where people will come out and actually like they'll review literature in the fitness and science, like health and wellness, whatever industry, and like share the articles and what they found. There's a lot of good podcasts out now and networks of people who are like scientists, researchers, or medical providers who all come together and produce evidence-based, like their own kind of position stand, you could say, based off their principles. So I would say, I mean, I don't, shameless plug for us on Instagram, but if you find through us and you go through the people we network with and we could share with, we cross post a lot of professionals who are doctors or, you know, researchers or scientists or like really well trained science communicators in health and fitness, and it can grow out from there. So I think a big thing with that is like cultivating your social media to work with you, not against you, is what I'm basically coming down to say.
Oh yeah. I myself just did some spring cleaning on my Instagram feed to make sure whoever I was following was bringing me inspiration, good educational content, content that was vetted. I want to point out that Karitha in the chat actually says she also finds that there are several newsletters from medical centers that address a lot for fitness and nutrition too. So really great point. There's a lot of good places to look. You just have to kind of get out there and also have some tips to apply so that when you are consuming information, you can do it with your critical thinking hat on. So speaking of tips, as we've been talking about, there is so much misinformation online. And as a consumer, it can be really tough to sort through that on your own without some guidance. But we have five tips for you guys today, and we're going to walk you through them. So the first one is to be weary of headlines that use words like proven or causes. So these buzzwords that are like really meant to lure you in. We call it clickbait online, right? Like really catchy things Alyssa, talk to us about that. Can you give us some examples?
Yeah, so this happens all the time. And this is a strategy we use on social media to get you guys to repost. So it can be good because it can get you to draw attention to things that are worth your time. But you guys see it all the time. You know, some family friend shared on Facebook a post with a flashy headline, and then your mom or your dad calls you and is like, did you see so-and-so share this post? Like, you know, blah, blah, blah. And that's how misinformation spreads, because a flashy headline tells you a overgeneralized consensus of something, and it's not the full truth. That if you had read the full article, or even sometimes when they're quoting scientific articles, if you had read that full article. And so they're going to use words that provoke emotion. So things that you're either insecure about, things that you're confused about, things that, like, they know that you have some sort of emotional reaction to, or we as humans do, and they're going to play on that and make it very reactionary. So then you're going to be, well, this has to be true, or yeah, you're going to pay attention to it more than the headline that says, you know, increasing physical activity 10 minutes a day is good for your health. Like, everyone's like, oh, whatever. But if someone says, you know, like, do this one magic hack to drop 20 pounds in 2 hours, like, everyone's like, oh yes, click on that right now. So you have to, like, if you have that response, I think it's important to pause and be like, okay, like, let's see what this actually is saying, rather than just taking that one sentence or one post or one article at face value and actually critically analyzing it. But I think a big thing is, like, to stop and be like, okay, what is my immediate response? Why am I drawn to this over something else, right? Because I even do it too, and I'm trained in this. Like, that's what advertising and marketing is for, right? It's the Doritos of the fitness headline industry. So
I love that analogy, Britt. I know we've talked about this before too, right? Like, those buzzwords, again, like proven causes. And the fact of the matter is that a lot of times science isn't proving something. So can you talk to us about that?
Yeah, a lot of times these really catchy articles, or, you know, Facebook posts or what have you, they will be talking about one study, like one singular study, which doesn't prove anything. I think, you know, there's a body of literature when it comes to a topic, and some topics are really well researched and others are not. Mm-hmm. So it's important to kind of know that whenever you're consuming this. If there's some off the wall study that says, I don't know, something weird that no other study has ever come to that conclusion, like, why? You know, as a consumer, why is there this one study that's just saying something totally opposite than what everything else claims? Every professional organization doesn't claim this. You know, it just seems like it doesn't quite fit. There's probably a reason why. And it could be we have more questions than answers still. So it's not proving anything, but it may suggest that more research needs to be done to answer these other questions that the study brought up. So, you know, proven is a strong term, right? There's very, very, very few things that we know for sure in anything. So it's important to just keep that critical lens always, especially when reading something that's trying to convey the findings of a study. And the findings might be really cool. There's a lot of really awesome findings from individual studies, but the actual state of the literature is not going to be found from just one study.
Yeah. And so, speaking of that, you know, our second tip is to teach people to go back to the primary source or the original source. So a lot of times you see, whether it's an Instagram post or even like a popular media article, trying to interpret a study, it can be really hard, even from reading that article, to understand the nitty-gritty details of a study, right? And so, Britt, kind of building on your last topic, talk to us about this.
Yeah, so I think some people have gotten better at providing sources, which I think is essential, right? If you're going to be making claims and say that it's based on evidence, you need to provide the evidence. So if it's not there, to ask for it, and that's not rude or that's necessarily discrediting someone. If they want you to understand this topic and they want to share this message with you, they will be happy to provide the evidence for you. What you'll often hear is some pushback if there is no evidence to support the claim. Yeah. And, you know, then there's no sources to be provided. So you're kind of then on your own to figure it out. And as a consumer, I don't necessarily think that's your job, right? I don't think that every single person who's watching this or who's interested in, you know, using science to help inform their opinions, I don't think you need to read academic articles all the time, right? But you can, you know, go to vetted sources that have provided the summaries for you. And if you think, oh, that sounds interesting, you can go directly to the article. Hopefully it's linked at the bottom. A lot of times it is with the reference. Even on Instagram, a lot of people are doing that now where you can search the article and find it, or they'll provide the reference for you. And if not, you can ask. But again, I always like to caution people that it is not your job to know how to read an academic article. So while you might understand the conclusion, you might not understand a lot of the other pieces of it, the statistical analysis that they use, the methodology that they use, was it appropriate? Those are all questions that you might not be able to answer as a consumer, and that's okay. That's why I think it's so important to lean on sources that are there to provide you with the information, and to trust those sources to help guide you, rather than, you know, I like the idea of skepticism, but I think it can go too far where if you're too skeptical of every single thing, then what? You know, you're left to your own devices. And if you're not trained in reading academic literature, that could just lead to a whole host of other questions that you just cannot answer. So I would say, yeah, definitely finding the sources, ask for one if it's not provided for you, and that is not rude. That is just asking for the evidence and wanting to search it yourself and read up on it yourself. And if the person is not making a claim that is not based on evidence, then they'll be happy to provide that for you.
I think this is all such helpful advice. And I just want to point out that the chat is blowing up, and we actually have people tuning in from Mexico, from Canada, from the UK, from New Jersey, from New York. I mean, this is so cool that we're getting to help so many of you from all over the world understand science communication a little bit more. So thank you guys so much for being here. Remember that you can add any questions or comments in the chat so that we can catch them and answer them live. Now, I have another really good question in here from Jenna that, Alyssa, I'd love your take on. So she's saying, how do you recommend talking to friends or relatives who don't believe in fact-based health and science without provoking a combative or defensive response? And I know, Alyssa, that, you know, you do this all the time on your social media pages with your presence, right? You're really helping people to understand and to not be scared, right? You're demanding better of people. And so what advice do you have for Jenna?
Yeah, so this is really hard because I think, kind of even tying back to the headline things, people get very emotionally tied to what they're doing and they don't want to know that they're wrong. Or a lot of people cling so hard to the exercise or diet system that they follow, even if it's ineffective, because then they have to, you know, admit fault or ask for help. And that can be really hard for all people, right? And so I think starting with knowing that, like, that defensiveness is coming from, it's not a them reacting towards you. It's just them kind of struggling with the same mixed messages that we're all getting from the health and fitness industry. There's a lot of frustration that underlies this. And I think the biggest thing, especially with me, with friends and family, because it's hard to get them to listen to you. My mom listens to me now more because she reads my Instagram posts than she does when it comes directly from my mouth. Ironically, that's the truth of the matter. I think it's like continuing to live by example with what you're doing, because eventually if they see it's working, they're going to get curious enough and be like, okay, maybe they're onto something. And just like being like, the thing that I do the most is I'm just honest and I communicate things and I educate and I explain why, but I never imply that people have to do anything. I just give them the resource or like the direction that they should take if this is their end goal, but I never say that they have to do it. So if people get defensive, it's usually them assuming that you're trying to force them into something that they want to do. I think it's the biggest thing is to just lead by example, keep doing what you're doing. Don't try to push it on them. I know that we always want our friends and family to be healthy and feel as good as we do, but I think that like if you let them come to you and you just keep living by that example and taking care of yourself and just like being open and honest and educating without like sounding like you're trying to talk down to them and what they're doing, they're going to be more likely, you're going to create that space for them to come towards you instead of pushing them away more.
I think that that's such useful advice. I think it's the knowing that you are doing the very best you can, right? And we also know that community and that social support is really important. So making sure that your friends and family do feel supported, if they do decide to kind of start tiptoeing into what you're doing, right? Or tiptoeing into learning a little bit more about their health and fitness, that they have you there to be supportive. So I love that advice too. So our next tip, number three, is to not just look for the information that says what you want to hear. And in science, we actually have a term for this called confirmation bias. Alyssa, tell the audience a little bit about what confirmation bias is.
Yeah, so we'll use a great example of this from what Brittany and I said about earlier. Brittany and I are both women who engaged in high levels of resistance training. So our bias inherently is that we think women should lift. That is supported by the scientific evidence, but say that we're going back 10, 20, 30 years or whatever, and we're on this new cusp of this crazy idea that women should resistance train. And we're going on the internet, I guess it exists in this hypothetical world. We would be going on there and looking for science that proves what we believe. So we're typing into Google, like, why resistance training is good for women, rather than also putting why resistance training is bad for women. You know what I mean? Like, we're not looking for the opposite argument. We're only looking for the argument that supports our argument, right? So we're going out there and seeking information that gives us that metaphorical pat on the back that what we're doing is correct and right. And with so much information that's good and bad on the internet, you're going to find good and bad for every single thing that you're doing, regardless of if it's actually good or bad based by like what we know in the scientific literature. So it's about being open to multiple opinions and views on things, but not just people's opinions and views, but just like actual general consensus of what we, you know to be true, but not seeking out only what supports yours, and especially when you're looking at resources or references that are maybe not as credible, but they support what you're saying. So it's like saying, well, I read a blog post that said that like I can't lift as a woman, or I have to lift as a woman, rather than saying, okay, well, like, these are the pros and cons of what I should do, and this is why I base my decision on this at the end of the day. So
yeah, and I think you said it best, like, everybody's coming into any situation with their own biases, right? But as a scientist, you actually are trained to be as objective as you possibly can when you're looking up information, which takes us into tip number four, Britt, checking for the credibility of the writer or the content creator, right? Because as we've mentioned, it can be really hard, even as experts, like, right? As the three of us sitting here, we have PhDs. Alyssa, you're like so close to having yours. We have spent decades at this point, like, studying and reading and learning how to critically read and think and take away take homes, but it's still hard for us. I mean, every day I see stuff and I'm like, what? Oh, I guess I should get into that more. And I think all of us can relate to that. So Britt, tell us some tips here.
Yeah. So I think, for one thing, I think a lot of people who attempt to communicate science, or that is their job, they're science communicators, either on the internet or in real life, they'll be very honest about their credentials, right? There will be no question as to what their training is, if they have it, and what that looks like. I think that it doesn't necessarily always have to be a specific degree, right? Like, you don't have to have a PhD to communicate science necessarily, but you do have to have experience reading research and being able to look at an entire body of evidence. And that goes back to the last point of confirmation bias, being able to know the body of literature and not just what is consistent with your opinion is important, because you can still form opinions based on the state of the literature if you know the state of it, but you might not if you're not trained in, you know, researching and knowing how to interpret the data. So I would say, you know, the credibility of the writer is really important, and the communicator, and a lot of times they'll be very honest about that, what their expertise is in. If it's something like a blog post, or maybe something that's not vetted by peer review, like an academic journal or something, a lot of times there are really highly qualified people who write blogs on topics that are of interest to you. So they could be a doctor or a, trainer that has a advanced degree, or, you know, one of us, we could write a blog about something that is, you know, based on the science. It provides all the references. It's still slightly biased, obviously, because everything has a hint of bias. However, if the person has no credibility at all, like, they don't have any credentials, they don't have any training, they don't have any formal certifications, they don't have any experience, and they're just stating kind of what they think is true, without any additional references or without any additional, things that they can point to as to why they think this, aside from personal anecdote, that's a big red flag, right? And obviously there are levels to this. It's not just either something is good or something is bad, but to really be able to look through and read through something, and at the end, do you feel like it is, you are able to then make a decision based on your personal situation? Or are you reading this and at the end feeling like they're trying to sell you something, or they're saying that their way is the only way and they have no evidence to support it or no evidence even suggesting otherwise, right? Because in health and fitness, as we know, there are a lot of different opinions on things and they're all based on some sort of science, right? So it's not like there's an answer. So I would say to just take note of the credibility of the writer and their training, their certifications, their expertise, and when they're extending beyond that. And then also just the overall messaging and tone of the content that you're consuming. Is it, you know, highly subjective? Is it selling you something that you maybe don't need or want, but making you feel a certain way, trying to elicit that response, like Alyssa was saying, by using these words that are buzzwords that just ping at your heartstrings, like they know that that's going to hit you. Mm-hmm. That's important to consider. So all of those things, I think, combined can, as a consumer, make a decision as to whether what you're reading and what you're taking in is credible.
Absolutely. We talked a little bit about this before, Britt, but a lot of people who are, you know, working towards becoming science communicators are well-intentioned. It's not like we think there are a lot of people out there, you know, trying to spread crazy information. We think most of the time it's well-intentioned, but again, if they haven't been trained in how to interpret science and understand all the nuances that science has, especially in a relatively young field like exercise science, which is compared to other related fields, quite young still, right, guys? Like, it's still kind of new that we're learning a lot every month as new publications come out. So speaking of nuance, this is our last tip. Alyssa, I want to ask you about this, because most of the time in science, things are not very black and white. There's a lot of nuance, and somebody who is well-trained is going to help you be able to identify it and pick out that nuance, right? Like, there's not a lot of absolute, like, keto is the best way to lose fat. Like, that's, you know, a very absolute statement that is not really supported by evidence, right? There's a lot of it depends there. So talk to us about that.
Yeah. So I think this is great to build off what Brittany just said, is that unfortunately, there are people who will have great credentials that will misuse their credentials and overextend beyond their expertise. So I think like a really good thing beyond just like people kind of having a general consensus with what most people are kind of saying, but like most people who are educated, well-intended, and know what they're talking about, is to some degree, their statement's going to say, well, it depends, because that it depends factors in you as an individual. We can make blatant statements of science and it could be the most optimal, perfect, absolute thing in the world. But being a good trainer, so our science translates to people a lot more than other fields, which is really important, because, you know, you guys train in Orange Theory Fitness and your coaches could come in and be like, you have to do this, you have to do this. And if that isn't ideal for you, then it's not going to work. So it's about being able to take that science that we know to be as true as we possibly know it to be. And you're going to find that a lot of these people are going to say, it depends, or, you know, some of the literature points towards this, but then there's another study that says this is nothing. So taking these together, there's probably a small chance that this is actually more beneficial, but, you know, the magnitude of that is probably not so great that it really matters if that's not possible for you, versus saying like, hey, this depends and this is what we know to be true, but in your unique situation, this is the way that we would apply this to make it the most optimal for you. You're going to find that the people that are really good at what they do are going to tell you that there's some variation, or, you know, it's not an only absolute answer. And like, yes, this is the absolute 100% only way to do this. And you'll see that a lot with misinformation or people who overstate. They're going to be like, you've been looking for the secret your whole life and we found it and this is the way to do it. And that's not ever going to be true, because humans are, you know, physiology is physiology, but we're so individual that you're going to find that most people are going to be like, hey, it depends on the situation, the person, a lot of the data says this, some of this is conflicting, this is what this rounds out about to say, and this is how we can apply it to you.
I love the fact that you added the you in there, because at Orange Theory, you're exactly right. We are training our coaches to focus on the people, and that's what creates the community feeling that we're known for, that people love, that keeps them coming back and staying consistent with an exercise routine. Rhonda says, great advice, and I could not agree more. Okay, so to round things out today, we have some hot topics and audience questions for you guys. Are you ready? Dun, 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 dun. The first one is for Britt. It is, why are so many celebrities pushing products with crazy claims?
I wish I had the answer to this. I do. I don't know, because I would say it's that they need the money, which they don't because they're celebrities. But I don't know. I don't know why they do it. But the thing to remember is that a lot of times what they are pushing is just like everything else that we've been talking about. We see a lot of celebrities pushing just really crazy things like the detox teas and the weird devices that you wear on your body that could be actually really harmful to you. So I think they just don't have as much to lose. So they feel comfortable really pushing it to a really, really large audience. Mm-hmm. And they already had that trust because people have bought into them and their brand and whatever they do, depending on what kind of celebrity is, it could be anything from a model to a musician, right? Push these crazy products that they have no credentials. If you were to ask them how it worked, they would not be able to tell you, right? So I think that's important to remember, that even though that they may be saying that this product is what makes them look the way they do, it's probably not true. And, you know, even my favorite celebrities fall prey to this. So it's not that it makes them a bad person or anything like that, but it's still the tips that we shared about spotting misinformation still apply to even someone like a celebrity that you might really enjoy what they do otherwise, but that doesn't mean that they may fall prey to misinformation as well. So always just be a conscious consumer.
I love that. Be a conscious consumer. So the second question, and I should say, these came from our Instagram story. So these are from the audience. And don't forget, guys, if you are tuning in live, to send us your questions in the chat, because we do have a couple more minutes and we can answer them on air, which will be really cool. So next question, Alyssa, is for you. How do you know when to believe a fitness influencer and when to be a little bit more apprehensive?
Yeah, so this can be really hard, right? Because I'm very pro social media for information, because it is becoming a lot more of an educational tool, which I think is the future of social media, which I think is incredible. And that's why I'm on there. So I think the biggest thing is, you'll see a lot of people who have no credentials. They don't even have a CPT, which is like immediately a big red flag that they're not even trying to show you that they're willing to get a degree or a certification to protect you and them. Like, that should be like that first kind of like, okay, like, why are they doing this? There's a lot of money to be made for selling fitness stuff on Instagram. So then what you'll see a lot of the time is that they're just telling you what worked for them, and they're showing you their exact workout or their exact diet, and they're selling you. So remember that nuisance, it depends and applying to you thing I just talked about before? It completely removes that. It's just someone who's reselling and repackaging what they did for you without understanding how to make it individual or like educating in a way that you could take that information and apply it to how it fits yourself. So I think that like lack of effort to even show you that they care as a professional to make sure that they're giving you the best information they can, and then just a lot of that regurgitation of what they did, and they're just selling you, they're just sharing their workout videos and like their nutrition and saying, this is what you need to do. And then, you know, what's their consistent message, right? Like, what's the direction of it? How does it make you feel? I know that's not like a scientifically valid thing, but if their message makes you feel really bad about yourself or really self-conscious, there's a lot of like psychological harm that can come from some of these pages. And so I think that, like, you know, are they preying on your insecurities for you, you know, to follow their content or buy their products? Are they making you using fear tactics to like push their message? Or do you feel like you're learning something and you feel empowered and like they're sharing their sources or where their information is? And if you're willing, if you ask them why or how something's working, they're willing to actually engage in that conversation back with you rather than being defensive. And I think the biggest thing is people saying, just trust me, or this is just how it works, or something along the lines of that. So I think like pay attention to people's consistent content, because one post might, you know, give you an idea. But over time, looking at the overall direction of their message, and if they're just saying a lot of like wishy-washy surface level stuff, but never actually getting into why or how things work, they're probably just telling you like something that they learned from somewhere on the internet and repackaging up for you and just giving to you because they did it and it worked for them. And there's no like nuisance, or, you know, it has that heavy level of their own bias. And it's all the things that we talked about before. Take all of those former ones and apply those skepticisms to these pages and vet them and say, okay, are they explaining to me why? Are they explaining to me how? Do they just make me feel really bad about myself when I follow them, rather than feeling like you're walking away and you gain something from that, that positively impacted your health or fitness?
I love that. That was such a good answer. Okay. So What about, this is one's for you, Britt. How many times per week should somebody come to OTF?
Yeah, so this is another it depends answer, but you know, our general recommendation is probably like 2 to 4 times per week for a workout like an Orange Theory workout. Now, that's not to say that you can't do other things on the days that you're not at OTF or that you can only be active 2 to 4 days per week, but with the higher intensity of a workout like that, you really want to make sure that you're recovering. You want to make sure that you are eating enough to support your workouts. You want to make sure that you're getting more from your workout than it's taking away, right? So you don't want to overexert yourself so that you're overtraining in any way and not recovering and not meeting your goals in the way that you want to. So for most people, that's going to fall somewhere between 2 to 4 times per week, right? And on the other days, if you want to offset that with other types of training to really round out your exercise routine, that's a great option as well. But typically that would be the recommendation of something that's a higher intensity, like an Orange Theory workout.
I love that it depends. We're applying all these tips to our answers to the FAQs, so I love it. Okay, so we got a lot of questions on Instagram about diet topics and really trendy diet topics to be exact. So one of the questions that kept coming up is, what's the deal with keto? Is it actually the best way to lose weight or fat quickly? And then we also had a couple of questions about fruit, like, is eating too much fruit bad for you? Is fruit causing obesity, right? There are a lot of, and these are coming straight from the Explore page on Instagram. I mean, I'm scrolling sometimes, I'm seeing these claims pop up here and there. And while none of us are registered dietitians, we are experts in physiology and metabolism. And so we can talk about this from a non-medical nutrition standpoint, right, Alyssa? So what would you say to people asking these like very extreme diet questions?
Yeah, so to give context to you guys, one of the things I research is metabolism, and the keto diet is something that I've had, like, especially in application with exercise, is something that I actually like have learned a lot about. And so I think it's important to say, not only does it depend, but like from an individual level, that's where we need to be making those dietary decisions rather than saying everyone needs to be doing one diet. I think that's so like reductionistic, like that's so silly for us to all say. And so a lot of people get drawn to stuff like keto because when you first do keto and you cut out, because the fruit and the keto thing falls into this fear of carbs that we have, is that initially you have this rapid weight loss because you store a lot of water with carbohydrate in your muscles, like they kind of get stored together in your muscles. And so when you initially remove that from your diet, you have this large rapid flux of weight. So it looks really effective, right? Like whenever we have really fast results, regardless of what we're doing in fitness, health, life, we're motivated by that. But that itself isn't fat loss. That's just water weight. So that's the same as like if you just dehydrated yourself for a few days, do not do that. And then the scale went down. So it has this immediate quick fix result. And then a lot of people find positives in keto because it has been shown to curb appetite a little bit more. So some people find a positive effect from that. But then overall, when we look at diets as a whole, finding individual preference is really important for adherence, and also knowing and understanding how to feed yourself in a way that supports your goals and activities is going to be what's going to be more likely long-term effective for you. So keto, it can work. I won't say it won't if you can find it long-term adherence with that, but a lot of people have a really hard time doing so because it can be a little bit more restrictive or need some more creative thought or effort, and a big barrier to health and fitness is the effort part and the mental effort that comes with making those choices. So if you do and it works, but then you go back to what you did before, you didn't gain or learn any knowledge, you just are back at square one, versus understanding that there's other dietary approaches you can take that might be more fitting for your life. And then when it comes to fruit and carbohydrates, because those are tied in with each other, you know, carbs get a bad rap, but carb needs are based on activity levels. So carbs aren't either good nor bad for you, but your need, the amount your body needs is going to largely depend on how active you are. So someone who's more active just is going to need more, versus if you're not as active, you won't need it, you'll need less, but that doesn't mean none, right? So I think keeping that in mind, that it's a shifting scale spectrum, but I think, you know, how many people are truly overeating fruit to the point that it's causing negative health issues? I mean, you don't see the news on Facebook. We don't see article that says, you know, woman dies of watermelon overdose at 55, right? Like we're not seeing these headlines. A lot of the foods that, you know, we should be consuming in moderation don't get as much of a bad rap as like, it's so silly to think that, you know, fruit and vegetables, things that are great for us just because they are a carb or a sugar, because that's what they are. That doesn't inherently make them bad. They have fiber, they're digested a little bit differently in our bodies. They have a lot of micronutrients that are really important for health. So I think tying those things all together is, you know, finding a system of eating that works for you, knowing that the big flashy results you see from these things are showing you usually an acute period of time, not the large long-term, and that fruit is good for you. Like, I think we can all confidently say fruit is good for you.
I actually got this question pretty recently from someone who was worried that they said sugar, but then they were mentioning things like fruit was the reason for their weight gain, and should they avoid it? Basically everything that, you know, you were just explaining. And whenever I was like, no, that's not true. Like, fruit actually has a lot of micronutrients. Like you're saying, there's no reason for you not to eat fruit. They were flabbergasted. They were like, but I thought that eating too much fruit and like the sugar and this and that, I'm like, you're working out 5 days a week. You know, you are lifting and you're doing cardiovascular activities. So you need to fuel yourself, and carbohydrates are going to help you do that. So yeah, I just to piggyback off that's a really common thing that I question that I hear actually. So people are wondering, and yeah, Alyssa did a great job explaining that.
I actually had somebody once sort of attack me on an Instagram story because I posted a picture of my 3-year-old son eating a banana, and the person said, you know, by giving him fruit like bananas, I was going to cause childhood obesity. And I was like, wow, there's just a lot going on here. We need to talk about this. So maybe that person is tuning in live to learn a little bit more about the benefits of having fruit included in your diet. I love the comments that are coming in. So Mary Carmen saying she loves carbs. We agree. Kelly is saying she loves a bowl of fresh berries every morning. Jenna is saying she eats oatmeal and berries every morning for breakfast and loves it. And so again, these are all examples of finding a diet that helps fuel the activities that you're doing, and also something that you can sustain long-term. And shameless plug for our next episode of Under the Orange Lights is actually with WW's Jackie London. She's a registered dietitian, and she'll be talking about questions just like this and busting a whole bunch of nutrition-related myths. So we hope you guys will join us for that as well. So Alyssa, Britt, we have covered so much ground over the past 47 minutes. I think lots of knowledge bombs in here for the audience who's tuning in live. Thank you guys so much for being here today and spreading some really positive science communication and some helpful tips for all of our audience. Audience members, before you head out, we do want to announce a special giveaway. So if you have an OTF More Life story, I know Neil, I saw yours in the chat earlier on. You have had a really positive experience with OTF. We want to hear about it. If you can send your story to social@orangetheory.com, you can be entered to win a free copy of Ellen Latham's book. She is our co-founder and creator of OTF and has authored a really incredible book. So we'd love to feature that. Go ahead and shoot us an email. And thank you all for being part of Under the Orange Lights, which is a live webcast dedicated to connecting the OTF community with industry experts ready to answer all of your questions. Make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel so that you never miss an episode. And until next time, stay healthy, everybody.